you're coming with. Live from New York, it's the Gary Null Show. And now, your host, Gary Null.
Hi, everyone. I'm Gary Null, and today you're going to learn about how turmeric stops cancer cell growth. A new study from Washington State University, published in Applied Materials and Interface, it's a major peer-reviewed journal, and we have a lot more on that. But then I'm going to take your calls. These are calls I haven't had a chance to take this week because of the special in-depth discussions, commentaries, and I will today. I'll get to them. And for those of you who are not aware that you can call in a special number and ask questions and or make a comment upon something that you felt was important, but maybe I didn't take calls that day or you didn't think well through it, and now you have and thought, I'd like to add something to that. Here's the number, 701-719-9976, 701-719-9976. Also, time permitting, a special commentary from one of the men I respect tremendously in this country. He's a constitutional lawyer. He and Danny Sheehan are two of the best. Now, there's several constitutional lawyers, but these guys are always at the forefront. They are absolutely fearless, knowing that they are in the crosshairs of surveillance of the security state, and it doesn't keep them quiet. About the omnipresent surveillance state, so we'll share that insight. Also, life aboard a slave ship. I want to have a little historical lesson so we can put in perspective what people went through when we did have slavery and what it was like, knowing your entire life you would be indentured. You would not be considered a human, but a commodity. And therefore, why we should look today honestly and openly at what we can do to learn the lessons of other people's suffering, the Japanese Americans, for example, the Native Americans, their genocide, their internment in what was nothing more than gulags, and that was the reservations, until there was gold or silver or oil found under the reservation, as was the case in Oklahoma or in down in Georgia, and they were taken somewhere else. So we need to know about this in order to see what we can do to make good on our understanding of their suffering and what we can do so it never happens again, and see that everyone who was a victim is given an opportunity to have something that we collectively as a society can, through our spiritual nature and humanistic values, give them, to give them the same opportunity that many of us had already had. So I'm going to do a whole series on this. Also, I'm going to do a lot of programs, about 20, on why it is so difficult to be able to just to get a bare living today, and why. Today we'll continue that. And also, Rachel Maddow's gone, she's gone someplace, I don't know where, about wanting to attack Venezuela, supporting intervention in the Middle East, and now attacking Julian Assange. She's wrong on all points. We'll address it. And I just want to mention that the latest article on medical apartheid is getting a tremendous response. I was just given an update by Richard Gale. These are just a few of the sites that are carrying it. Global Research, one of the most respected sites in the world. And when Global Research carries something, it's generally then picked up by hundreds, if not thousands, of other sites. Health Impact News, Natural Blaze, Activist Post, Countercurrents, India, Nation and State, Taste and Style Magazine, Positive Universe, Peace, Compassion, and Understanding, Daily News Collective, Collapse of Industrial Civilization, a major Dutch place in organic consumers. And I'll get a little bit more into that later of why these are important. Now, next week, just to give you a heads up, I'm going to have 2 days set aside for classrooms on the air, meaning the entire hour will be taken with in-depth understanding of something that we all need to know about. And so it'll break the normal pattern of health and nutrition and then consumer listener responses and questions and then environmental news, etc. And so because these are really important topics and they're original and you haven't heard them before. So both of those are coming and they always involve our freedoms and our rights. Now here's the irony. There are people who say, I want to hear about carrots. Gary, I don't want to hear about police state and, you know, I'm okay. What happens when the only carrot you can eat is genetically modified? Would you care when you can't take any supplements because the pharmaceutical industry, capturing the FDA, has mandated that they're a danger, even though there's a 500,000 studies in the government's own literature showing they're safe and effective? Would you care then? So what we have is we have people who are intentionally negligent, and as a result, they're intentionally ignorant. And boy, does that put you in a vulnerable and dangerous position. So for those of you who don't want to be in that position, who want to be intentionally aware and informed so you can decide on your own what you want to do, 2 big shows next week. We start today with a study from Washington State University. A team has developed a system of using curcumin, C-U-R-C-U-M-I-N, that's the main ingredient in the spice turmeric, that successfully inhibits bone cancer cells and at the same time promotes the growth of healthy bone cells. The work could lead to a better post-operative treatments for people with osteosarcoma. By the way, that's the second most prevalent cancer death in children. So that's good news. And I suggest you take turmeric every day anyhow, or curcumin. There's also a study out of the University of Illinois on phenols, P-H-E-N-O-L-S, in cacao bean shells. Now, this isn't the cacao itself. This is that little pod, the brown pod that it comes in. Because it's not just sometimes the berry on a tree. It's the leaf. It's the stem. It's the bark. It's the sap. There's a lot of different medicinal values in plants, not just the part that we consume. By the way, that's true with soursop. Now, I just had some soursop the other day, and I grow soursop, and some jackfruit, and a lot of exotics that I've been planting for decades. And it's kind of a bitter, sweet, not a lot of material to eat. It's mainly seeds. But the leaves of the soursop are actually more medicinally valuable than soursop itself. If you go to the Caribbean, anywhere, Jamaica, Trinidad, they'll tell you that. And most of them are growing it wild, and they use it just like they do cherimoya. But anyhow, when they did research on this, they found that the phenols in the bean shells was very important in helping to help a person lose weight. It has an effect upon fat and also the immune system. It boosts the immune system and helps the body better burn fat. And this was published in the Journal of Molecular Nutrition and Food Research. Also, vitamin D, when you do not have enough, when you're deficient, puts you at a greater risk for thyroid cancer. This is from the University of Shandong in China. So according to this report, the association between vitamin D deficiency and thyroid cancer has now been demonstrated, and that is important. So, the answer? Make sure you're getting about 2,000 to 5,000 units of vitamin D3 every day, or get out in the sun. But unfortunately, the people living in the sun, like in Southern California, and it's kind of weird over there, you could walk down some of the streets and you would think that you're in an old Wild West town from the 1800s because everything looks shriveled and leathery. And the people's skin is bad. Oh, and then they tell you they're 23 years old. And you go, whoa, and your eyes open up. And you think, okay, better use a little bit more olive oil on your skin. About 3,000 gallons per cheek. In any case, so someone finally got the message, maybe just laying in the sun all day until you're three collars off your normal collar isn't a good idea. Promotes oxidative stress and damage to the skin. So the idea is, if you lather up with all that very toxic sunscreen, you then have that going into your blood, and that's not good. So get some sun, like 45 minutes over half your body, and that's going to give you about 20,000 units of vitamin D. And take some vitamin C and vitamin E when you come out of the sun, because that absorbs some of the free radicals and prevents sunburn. From Tufts University School of Nutrition Science, published in the Journal of the Academy of Nutrition and Dietetics, Americans still eat too much processed meat and too little fish. Let me think. Wonder why. Well, let's just take where most people get their messages, off the internet and off television, where they get most of the ads that they actually watch. Well, on television. So when you're sitting there watching something you want to see, and then the ad says, "We got the meat." Yeah, okay, that's fine. And better that the meat were left on the cows. So then they could say, "We got the cows." Okay, good. I'm glad you got cows. Now let them run and let them go eat some grass someplace in Wyoming and stay away from them. But that's not the way it works. So they show you how many different types of meat, all toxic, all can cause cancer, all are destructive to your immune system, that you can put into your body. And then someone else comes up with another one and says, "Well, we've got meat and eggs." And someone says, "Well, we got meat, eggs, and bacon." Then we got meat, eggs, bacon, and French fries. And we got the same thing, French fries, and we have, I just saw one, they had chicken, eggs, bacon, hash browns, and I think onion rings. Some huge monstrosity of a piece of garbage. You would be healthier if you licked a curb on 42nd and Broadway. But I don't think we'll see that happening unless someone is smart enough to actually glue $100 bills, and then politicians be out there in a second licking it. In any case, what we have, I cannot tell you the contempt I have for all politicians. I make no exceptions because, man, anyone who needs power in your life is the last person to have power in your life. Now, if a person came who didn't want to be a politician, would rather just be an ambassador for the people, yeah. And when was the last time we had someone like that? How about never? So, in any case, in this latest study, we're just eating way too much meat. Will it stop us? Not at all. In fact, people will mock that, and you know, they'll have their beer, that's nitrates, with their sandwich. And the sandwich will have two types of cancer-causing agents. And so then when that person one day, after belching for about 6 months straight and having gas that makes them look like a balloon deflating around the room, and then they're laying on a couch where there's a permanent indentation from their morbid obesity, and they're hacking and coughing with little oozy woozies coming out of the side of their mouth and saying, "I don't feel well." Really? What in the world could possibly be wrong with you? Yeah. So that's, God, we're a mess, aren't we? So anyhow, get off the meat if you care about your health. Also, when was the last time you took a vacation? Who can take a vacation, Gary? We're serious. We're professionals. We have stuff to buy. And our kids have even more stuff to buy, and they don't have any value for anything. They only know the price, and they want to spend more because it shows that somehow they're successful. Our parents can give us a credit card that's a black American Express card, meaning there's no limit. So we're going to go out there and we're going to buy something we don't need to prove to other people that they should pay attention to us because we're significant. Well, that's about 40 million kids. So when did you, just an average person, say, "Hold on a second, I'm not rich, I'm not famous, I don't have a bunch of spoiled brat kids, my kids are decent kids," and they know there's a consequence if they act out, "but we need a vacation." Okay, everyone needs a vacation. We just don't take them. And when we do take them, we don't take them. Have you ever noticed, okay, we're here, we're in Paris, let's see everything. By the way, we're kind of wealthy, and our parents don't want us disappointed, because when we get disappointed, we cry, and then they have to send psychologists in with teddy bears that we have to hug for 3 hours. Could you reenact the fire of Notre Dame so at least we can say we saw something? Well, that's kind of past us, and they're rebuilding it now. Is there anything else we can do? Can we take you into the sewers? We'll do that. How about I'll lead you on a guide. Let's go traipsing through the sewers. And there's probably still some residue from the guillotine in the 1790s, 92, 93. Want to see that? I don't think so. That's where all these young people should spend their summer vacation, in the sewers of... In any case, Syracuse University came up... I guess it was my... I had too much green juice this morning. So, new research provides medical proof the vacation is good for your heart, unless you take your laptop with you, unless you go to a place that everyone else is going to. Let's go to the Grand Canyon. Let's go to Yellowstone. Ever been to Yellowstone? Nice place. Nice place to see. Wonderful to see the bison and the wolves. Not a nice place in the summertime because there's like a 20 miles of cars and you're all waiting in line. And you're all waiting to get into the park so that you're all looking at the back of other people's heads that are looking at something ahead of them that you find out is a geyser. It's just, it's a mob scene. Imagine New Year's Eve in Times Square. That's what visiting Yellowstone is. But before you get to Yellowstone, an hour before that, you're at the Grand Tetons. That's a far more interesting mountain range to see. It was donated by the Rockefellers. It's one of the greatest national parks in America. Very sparsely visited. But you got to get someplace and relax and enjoy yourself. Just chill out. Not with headsets, not with laptops. Disconnect. Now when Americans go to any country, they first take a look at the Spanish, the Italians, the Greeks, and the French, who take the month of August off. And when you see them at the beaches, there's a whole family, extended families. You see them having a meal that can go on for hours. There's laughter, there's joy, there's music, there's singing, there's arguments. There's some in Italy, they're smacking. And then there's music and loving it and smacking again. And so important. So I've been there. I can tell you that's actually true. But... What you got to understand is, Americans, you can always tell. I'm sitting in San Sebastian, right on the water. It was absolutely perfection of a neat big sky and the stars, the moon, and the best tasting garlic I've ever had in my life. And there's Americans sitting right across from me, and they had finished their meal in 15 minutes. And when they look around at everybody, everybody's looking at them like, what is going on with their Americans? Well, now Americans, when they have to detach from their electronic gear, they go through withdrawal, literally. And you can always tell, it's almost like night of the almost dead, the hyperkinetic on Valium. They're coming down, and they're not attached to anything, and they're not communicating with anyone, and they don't know what the hell to do with that moment. So they kind of shake and throb. Knees jerk out, their head jerks from side to side, almost like an exorcist. So you always know an American when they go on vacation. Boy, do we have a trouble relaxing and de-stressing and laughing at ourselves. Never laugh at ourselves, Gary. We can't laugh at anyone. That is politically incorrect. No, you should laugh at everyone, and especially laugh at the people who don't know how to laugh. And that'll send them to get two pillows to hug in the same moment. In any case, we all treasure our vacation time and look forward to that time when we can get away from work. So according to Syracuse University, with the arrival of summer, and today I believe is the first day of summer, it's good for our heart. That's correct. It's really good for our heart. So if you want to have a healthier heart, take a vacation. And finally, from Auburn and Midwestern universities, resveratrol, that's what you get when you eat the grapes, grape skin and grape seed, and exercise, found to reduce the risk of bone fractures in those with Alzheimer's. And we know that a lot of people with Alzheimer's and dementia have fractures and problems. So anyone you know who has dementia, memory loss, Alzheimer's, see that they get 300 milligrams, 115 in the morning, 115 in the afternoon, and get them walking if nothing else. It'll make a big difference in helping them. We're going to take a break and come right back. And when we come back, we're going right into your questions. Please stay with us.
My name is Michael. I would like to know if eating soy every day, soy milk or soy junk every day, I'm over 50 years, if it's good, and for a male or a female too, if it's good for every daily use. Thank you.
No, it is not. Using soy as just one small part of a large variety of other foods is completely good if it's organic and non-GMO, especially the tofu or fermented soy, such as miso. Then it's fine. It's providing probacteria to the body. But soy taken too frequently can also cause problems with your thyroid gland. And in China, you rarely see the problems with goiter, not because of the amount of soy, because we have been led to believe of those who are against soy that, oh, the soy is just dominant in the diet. It is not. It is not. Root vegetables are common. Grains are common, like rice, and sea vegetables and seaweeds, and also a whole lot of fermented foods and fish. That's the dominance in the Chinese and Japanese diet historically. Now, today, it is more meat in the Chinese diet and the Japanese diet, but the Japanese are still the longest-lived people in the world as a group. So I hope that answers your question. We'll take one more. Go ahead, please.
Hi. I was calling to leave a message in reference to what Gary was referring to today in talking about millennials and their struggle, which is true. All of his points were very valid, what he discussed today. But one point that's not being getting kind of left out, which was really, in my opinion, one of the most important, which he did touch upon, is the amount of rent that it costs to live anywhere nowadays. I mean, the rents are so high that it makes it, unfortunately, almost impossible, unless you have a good job, like what Gary is saying, to really afford it. And, you know, the thing about New York City, I've been here my whole life, the thing about New York City was that there were a lot of artists and creative thinking people. And because of the rents being so high, all those people that thought creatively and were artists, those people, I don't know where they went, but it's just, that's why you have, you know, people don't think as much anymore because it's hard. You know, people are just struggling to pay rent, which are just, you know, that which is a whole other category as well, because, you know, the people that own the buildings are in cahoots with each other to raise the rent to the highest possible level, not caring about other people, and therefore, you know, it just affects the majority of people. You know, you have a handful of people that are just affecting, you know, everybody by charging, you know, extreme rents. Anyway, you know, I hope Gary talks about that at some point. And love the show. It's amazing. Been listening to it for years and years. And keep doing what you guys are doing. Thanks. Bye.
Okay. You have made several valid points. Thank you for calling in and sharing those. In my commentary about why millennials are having a hard time paying rent, it depends upon which millennials you're referring to. There's two employees of mine that asked me, would I help them find living space in Manhattan near the office. This was when we were on 83rd and Broadway for 20 years plus. So I went around for about a week every day, and we would look at little rooms. And when I say a little room, I mean a little room, single room. And it was so bad that the listing agent would say, you got to bring your check when you come because this is going to be gone 5 minutes later. And I would literally see two or three brokers waiting for the first broker who was first in line to show the property. So he wasn't kidding. And you would go in, and these are these old brownstones. They really were aesthetically unappealing. They were old. They're frequently just old windows. And in some cases, they didn't even have a bathroom or a kitchen in the apartment. There was one over in Riverside Drive, $1,100 a month, no bathroom inside. You had to use a common bathroom outside, and you didn't have a kitchen. And literally, one of the people would go out every day and go to health food stores and buy their prepared foods, hot or cold, and because they were an artist. And this particular person's a singer and dancer, but doesn't have the gigs or the money or the fame to afford anything else. At the end of it, the best we could do was to find a place and that they would have to have two living in the space. The space was probably about, I'm going to say, 600 square feet. Okay, two people can live in a space like that, but I said, you got to have your own private bathroom and a mini kitchen or the right to put in a mini kitchen. And that ended up being $1,300, and that was on the Upper West Side. The cause is greed, not just the landlords. They have been historically greedy. The cause is the average person seeing that they can exploit this situation by renting out their apartments and moving someplace else themselves. You're dealing with a human condition that will not change in the near future. My suggestion is simple. For those of you who do not come from wealthy parents who can help pay for it or subsidize it, you don't want to be living in New York just to work. There is no point to that. Nobody ever moves to New York for their health or happiness. You move there because of career possibilities and cultural enrichment. But if you have money or your parents have money and if that's being subsidized, then you actually can spend time de-stressing by enjoying what the city has to offer, whether it's its museums or its parks, and also the people in the different environments. But otherwise, I would suggest you start looking for places that are not expensive but still have quality of life, where you could rent a whole large two-bedroom apartment, maybe 1,400, 1,600 square feet for $700 a month. We have hundreds of cities and thousands of communities around the United States where you can live like that. But if you're drawn to that big city because you think that's where you're going to make your break, then you've got to go over to Hoboken, which now is booming, or Fort Lee booming, or Jersey City booming, or you got to commute for an hour and a half each day, and that's not worth it. Ask yourself, you can only be this age and live this time once. This whole idea that somehow we have to work until we're successful, and then have families, and then buy stuff, and then be obligated for all the debt that we have, so we can't stop working, we got to work harder and longer. This entire mindset must change. The purpose of being alive is not to work. To create, yes. We're going to go over and say hello to Rich Gale. Hi, Richard.
Hi, Gary.
Okay, Richard, we're doing a new series where we're challenging the Wikipedia editors who call themselves expert or pretend to be experts and edit everything on health and science as if they are the final arbiters. These are the grand inquisitors. Whatever they say is the gospel and anything else is heretical. And they've been destroying people's reputations with the full help and support and enabling of Jimmy Wales. And so what we're doing now, we're going to do a whole series of deconstructing the fact that they're not experts, should never be considered objective because on these issues, because they have not shown any objectivity. In point of fact, using their own words, an entire team of us over the next year will be doing over 100 reports showing you they're wrong about almost everything they write about, and yet they're wrong about whole fields, holistic and complementary medicine, traditional Chinese medicine, etc. So which one are you going to take on today?
We're going to look at, because you had also mentioned about the presence of the study that was done by the Environmental Working Group. that identified glyphosate in all the children's kids' cereals. And these are levels way beyond the recommended allowed amount of glyphosate. There is a 160 parts per billion. And so we were going to look at what Wikipedia has been saying about glyphosate and Roundup. And we know for a fact that the Monsanto glyphosate pages, the Roundup pages, some other pesticides are being controlled by skeptics. Not necessarily the same skeptics that are the ones that are dealing with alternative health. It looks like it's a different group. But nevertheless, this is it's not just a battle between different medical ideologies or medical theories. It's the politicizing of medicine and health. And the skeptics are operating more, I think, coming from a political view rather than anything that's really scientific, because they're supporting a particular agenda, and that's very clear, and to try to marginalize and eradicate or discredit that any kind of therapies or science that is contrary to their point of view. So when we look at the glyphosate page, what's kind of interesting is since there's so much controversy around Roundup right now, you would expect that Wikipedia has to mention it. You can't get away from it. There's so many different international agencies that are now calling glyphosate a carcinogen. So that has to get posted. But it's the way it's being posted, because the emphasis is on those studies and agencies that are questioning the toxicity of glyphosate. It's a very long page, and what's kind of interesting is that when you go to the bottom of wiki pages, you'll see the controversies, the sections on, and it's only three short paragraphs, and one is just one single line. It says that the 2010 study found that the United States GM crops also provide a number of ecological benefits, and there is a reference to a 2016 systematic review and meta-analysis found no causal relationship between glyphosate exposure and the risk of any type of lymphopoietic cancer, including non-Hodgkin's lymphoma and multiple myeloma. So this is referenced, and I decided, okay, let me see where they're getting the reference from. And it goes to a company, Exponent Inc. It's a private chemical consultancy company. They're a publicly traded giant that deals with providing research and analysis to defend large corporations in litigation. The magazine Business Ethics published a big, large expose on that. And what we find about this group is that in the 1990s, they supported the tobacco industry, to deny lung cancer. They're funded by Chevron and Exxon. They claim that pollution from oil sites poses no cancer risk. They deny that pesticides, contribute to honeybee collapse. And I also came across some leaked emails that showed that the senior executive at this Exponent Inc. was communicating directly with Kimberly Hodge Bell, who happens to be Monsanto's senior toxicologist. And apparently some of this came up during all this litigation. But on the Wikipedia page, there is no mention, no references at all to the recent $2 billion verdict to the couple in the third Roundup case. And there's thousands pending. There's no referencing to this. There was also some editor tried to add a line that in 1996, the New York Attorney General filed a Roundup lawsuit against Monsanto for falsely advertising that the weed killer was as being safer than table salt. Wikipedia editors, skeptic editors had that line removed from it. So that's just kind of a little summary of what's going on here. And the Environmental Working Group, that they're an excellent organization, because this is a team of scientists and policy experts, lawyers, programmers, a nonprofit, nonpartisan organization that's only dedicated to protecting human health, the environment, like what's in your tap water. They have several research laboratories. They'll want to know what chemicals are in your shampoos you use or what kind of toxins might be, lurking underneath your sink and the cleaning products you have. Or they might, they look at the amount of pesticide residue in your food, or what would fracking wells and factories in your backyard be doing to you, what are in GMOs and how that's affecting your land and water. So they're an excellent organization, and they're the ones that did this large review that we were talking about before, finding that all kids' cereals that contain oats, which is perhaps almost all kids' cereals have some degree of oats, mostly all the cereals that are being manufactured by Quaker and General Mills had levels of glyphosate way, way, way beyond the parts per million that's regarded as safe. And of course, these figures of safety is completely irrelevant and very misleading. If a child happens to love oatmeal and comes and wants oatmeal for every breakfast, lunch, and dinner, they're going to get an enormous amount of glyphosate from that.
Okay, so what you're saying is that the editors on Wikipedia chose to exclude the damaging material on glyphosate and attachment from glyphosate to Roundup, Roundup to Monsanto, and then the other reports, including Professor Seralini's report showing mammary tumors at 1 year, or the full life of the rats that were used when no studies had gone beyond 3 months. And then we figured it out that no studies had gone beyond 3 months because the tumors start to form after 3 months. So clearly all the people involved in the pesticide industry knew that if you did a study that went for the full length of a rat, it would destroy the chemical and the company's reputation. But if you stopped it before the tumors manifested, then you could say, see, we gave them, we fed rats and it didn't get it. Anyhow, thank you, Richard, and write that up and let's post it. So yesterday's article on Paul Offit will be posted, and this one will be posted also by Monday. Thank you, Richard. By the way, with all this war talk and propaganda on left and right media and how, they did wrong and the proof of it, I want to thank Geraldo Rivera. I used to appear on Geraldo's show to debate industry people long ago when he had a show. But Geraldo last night on Sean Hannity had just met with the ambassador, Iranian ambassador, and they said that they had absolute proof, photographic proof, that the missile, drone was shot down within 3 miles of their shore, which just means their territorial water. And so all that Geraldo was doing is, before you go into war, wait and look at their evidence. Their evidence is there. It either is convincing or it's not. But don't preclude looking at the evidence. And Sean Hannity just went ballistic because he wants war and he wants doubling the amount of money for the defense budget. He is a super, super hawk. This guy is just, he just is not looking for the truth. Now, also, I want to thank Tucker Carlson, because virtually all the people that you saw on television, conservative and liberal media yesterday, were all from the military-industrial complex, from the deep state. And why in the world would any liberal trust the word of people who were embedded in the CIA and ran black op operations and were part of undermining legitimately democratically elected governments, were involved in regime change? And these are the people who are now being hired by MSNBC and CNN and PBS and other places. There was only one person that I could find in all media yesterday who brought on a person who was a colonel who has been consistent in saying, these are all lies. These are people who need a war. Their industries profit from these wars, and they are putting all their soldiers to go forward, their admirals and their joint chiefs of staff and their top four-star generals, who use their credentials as if they're certain that they're correct. And this guy said, no, they're not. And he has been consistent. That was Tucker Carlson. So once again, though I disagree on many things, Tucker Carlson, you have been the only show. First, you did something really courageous yesterday. You stood up and you really, you eviscerated the image of the Koch brothers. And secondly, you've only had people on your show who were against the invasions in Syria and now in Iran. And we need people in the media who are willing to go against everyone else and tell the truth. It's appreciated. Now, and by the way, I'm just now told that my webinar on how to reverse your aging and look younger, feel younger, be younger, have a younger heart and brain, add another 30 years, up to 30 years onto your lifespan, that is filled. Sorry if you didn't get in. And all that we can do now is put people on a wait list. And if someone cancels, then we'll, and there's always people to cancel, but you got to sign up early for these. Anyhow, that's Sunday at noon, and I'm looking forward to that. Now, we're going to go on now. And since the gentleman called in and asked about rent and how tough it is, I wanted to finish with this. And for all of our stations that end at 55 minutes, this is going to be a little longer. We'll get it in before the top of the hour. But in today's economy, even two-income professional families are struggling to make ends meet. Here's just one more of those stories that we need to hear.
It's part of what you're hearing from voters and on the campaign trail this year. Tonight, we zero in on the case of a California family feeling the squeeze. It's part of our joint project with American Public Media's Marketplace and PBS's Frontline, and it's called How the Deck is Stacked. It's funded by the Corporation for...
Can I call my insurance first to make the claim?
Yeah. Do you think it's totaled?
Yeah.
This has not been a good morning for Aaron and Mary Murray and Vandy, their five-year-old daughter. They came out to find Aaron's car had been hit overnight, one of those unexpected expenses that can throw a lot of middle-class families off track.
Thank you for calling insurance. My name is Rebecca. How can I help?
Hello, Rebecca. I am calling because my car got sideswiped. I did not see them. They just left the note on my car. And the note that they swerved to avoid a cat dashing across the street.
Okay.
Got a break for animals.
Things get back on track, though, with Mary's car, and they head to the Los Angeles Zoo to meet some friends. Vandy's really looking forward to the dinosaurs.
All right, are you guys ready? Oh, my gosh.
Oh,
well, I don't like it.
It's okay. I'll protect you.
He makes noise. I think he's real.
Over a standard zoo lunch of chicken fingers, talk turns back to that car accident.
The check goes to pay off the car. It doesn't come to me.
Next up, groceries at Target. And Vandy is eager to help.
Fruit, taco kit, and George Betty.
Nice. High five. Boom! Awesome.
Mary keeps a close eye on the family budget. Money-saving apps are the key.
Bread. Any bread. Unlocked. Cha-ching. 25 cents.
All right.
So that works anyways.
The tricky thing when you're talking about the middle class is who exactly you're talking about. One definition, according to the Pew Research Center, is a family of four making between $48,000 and $145,000 a year, which is basically the Murrays. They're both teachers. Household income is right at $90,000. And they're the ones that politicians talk about all the time.
Hey, how are you?
Hello.
This is Vandy.
Hi, Vandy. How are you, sweetie? You good?
Yeah.
Crazy day today? Yeah. You walk out to, Aaron, you walked out to get your laptop?
I had been sideswiped this morning. Like, the rear axle's broke.
Yep, that's part of it.
Is that part of the wheel?
Yeah, that's the wheel.
The tow truck's here.
How big of a pain is this? You're insured, but.
That's exactly it. I'm insured, but. Even if they pay everything out, I now don't have a car. Do we get a new car, you know? How do we find the money to get the down payment? Like, that's really the big thing.
So what's that gonna do to your monthly budget?
This month is shot. Right. Like, this month is shot, next month is shot. Right. I'm a teacher, I don't get paid over the summer.
As you try to get ahead, this is like two steps back, maybe more.
They say they're going to cover everything, but covering everything is never everything.
Our family, the Murrays.
Yeah.
They make $90,000 a year.
Yeah.
Now, granted, they live in L.A., an expensive part of the country. Housing is ridiculous.
Yeah.
They're middle class, right?
They would be, yeah, by definition.
Jennifer Pate is an economist at Loyola Marymount University. When we hear politicians and others say the middle class in America is being hollowed out, what does that mean? It means it's getting smaller?
Yeah, people are either going up, which is called upward mobility, or more likely, it's downward mobility. We're seeing a hollowing out of the middle. These are people who purchase goods and services across a year that leads to higher economic prosperity in our country. Well, what do families do when they struggle?
They don't spend, right? They
spend
retrench.
Less. They sometimes have to take jobs that have better security but pay lower wages. Wages have been stagnant in real terms since roughly the mid-70s.
Our family, the Murrays.
Yeah.
They're teachers. They're, you know, they're hustling to get by. Getting their car wrecked was not in their budget.
When you're living very close to your means or just barely within your means, when you have catastrophic events, right, something like having your car get totaled unexpectedly, that disproportionately weighs on you.
I don't feel middle class. I'd like to feel middle class. I don't. I hardly even feel like an adult.
We asked the Murrays whether they expected things to turn out like this.
In my best remembrance, we actually had planned on like having bought a house, mm-hmm. even here in L.A., mm-hmm. We were going to have somebody's loans paid off.
Yeah, and I would be done with my master's program and in a teaching job for LAUSD.
All right, so run me through that. How do we do?
No loans are paid off. We do not have a house.
I hate to say student loans are the only reason, but they are a large reason. I could have purchased a house for the amount of my student loans.
Are there months you choose not to pay bills?
I have, from time to time, chosen not to pay something or to skip something. You know, I never skip the rent, I never skip the car payment, I never skip the insurance.
When you look at this election, do you feel like the politicians and the campaigns and the candidates are paying attention to your situation? Hillary Clinton talks about the middle class all the time. Donald Trump has a middle class element in his platform.
Yeah. But I don't think that they see the reality of middle class. I think that there's an idea of what middle class is, which, I mean, I think middle class is, you know, you don't live paycheck to paycheck.
Do you think your fortunes are going to change based on this election?
I don't.
Maybe a better question, though, is what about the fortunes of their daughter?
Are you two setting Vandy up to be better off?
Okay, that's just one family, but it represents millions. You see, when all this conversation about we're being very prosperous today, some industries are. The financial industry is, yes. Equity partners, those who deal in exotic derivatives, yes. Those who can go in and buy up 150,000 foreclosed homes, then turn around and rent them out at very high rents, yeah. But what about if something goes wrong? What if you need a plumber, electrician? What if something happens to refrigeration? Well, there are no superintendents. Ah, so what normally would be, you would have a superintendent and they would take care of anything went wrong. Now you're on your own. That's the new reality of renting. So whatever the market will bear, that's what people are forced to pay. The landlords don't care. What about the 102 million Americans who used to work full-time and were part of our working middle class, who today don't have any jobs or only work part-time, and they're not even included in the official unemployment level numbers of 3.8%, which would mean that our real unemployment is anywhere on the low end of 17% to a high of 22%. If we said the United States had an official unemployment level that was real at 22%, we would be mocked all over the world. And yet, we lie about prosperity. Yeah, we'll show all the people who are prosperous, but we won't show you the people who are struggling. We'd like you to think that all the people living on the street in Seattle, Portland, Los Angeles, and San Francisco who are drug addicts, about 90%, and defecating in the street, that's homelessness. It isn't. Over 20 million Americans are not living on the streets that way. Some are living in their cars. Some are living in recreational vehicles. Others are living in in-laws' house. It's called couch surfing. I know that if I had to take in friends from high school who were homeless. They had their whole careers, raised families, and then things went south for them. And then one day you get a call, Gary, can I get some help? I'm in trouble. What kind of trouble are you in? Well, I'm homeless. And how did you get homeless? Sure, you can come. You're always welcome in my house. One time I had six of these people living at the same time. Ironic, because four of the six all went to the same high school. We all grew up together and all had good families and middle-class lifestyles until things went south. Why are those people's stories never told, never highlighted, never acknowledged? But they're real. So 99% of the homeless in America are never the point of focus. 99% of the unemployed, the permanent unemployed, are never a point of focus. There's no help for them. What about the people living under usurious debt, like payday loans and credit cards? They can't afford to pay, so all their credit cards go up in interest, compounding interest. Why don't we take a look at what happens when they go in and buy a couch for an apartment or a television and maybe spend $800 and then have to spend $2,000 to $3,000 in interest over the period of that payday loan? Why don't we show who's behind the payday loans? Why don't we show the legislators who took money? Why don't we show what it means to not get bail, even though you're innocent and you're forced to plead to get out at all? Why don't we show the innocent? 40% of all people incarcerated are shown to be innocent by the Innocent Project. Why don't we show that? Why don't we show not just Flint, where they threw out the lawsuit against the polluted water, but the 5,000 communities in America that have water as polluted as Flint? Why don't we see that in our prosperity reports? Why don't we show all the farmers right now whose land are completely dead because of the flooding and haven't planted a seed? Why don't we show how they're going to get through the year, pay their bills? They'll be the next people foreclosed on. We're talking about hundreds of thousands of farmers. Why isn't that story worth covering? Because if we start showing all the real stories of all Americans and not just focusing upon the celebrities and the super rich, then we would be embarrassed by what we've become. And that wouldn't continue to be a part of the moniker of our exceptionalism. Just something to think about. But here, we'll be bringing you those stories and sharing you the truth of other people's realities. I'm Gary Null. Thank you all for listening and have a nice day.